Good morning. I hope this finds you guys really well and trying to stay cool. It is July in St. Louis, isn't it? We can't escape it. We're so glad to see you this week at Porch Shop Tuesday. You saw that we were under the shade. We just decided that we had to move over, but so many of you came out to meet Pastor Linda, who will be with us again this week. She's really wanting to meet people in that kind of setting in the mission field, outdoors, safe and masked. And we were so celebratory. You've heard all about our CommunityWise campaign this month for July in partnership with Webster Hills. Hopefully you've joined the page on Facebook and you've shared it with your neighbors, either through social media or through just saying, "Hey, our church is doing something this month. You want to help us out?" We're just trying to help this great organization called LifeWise out. I think they give about 9,000 diapers a week, and they're given $15,000 worth of food, or at least they've done 9,000 diapers since March. It's a lot of diapers, but so we are trying. We've been challenged by Webster Hills to collect 10,000, and this week we made it to 3,600. So we're more than a third of the way there, and they're doing a collection tomorrow, Saturday, and they hope to have 5,000 the first day. So we've not only got to surpass that on the second day, we've got to blow it out of the water and get closer to our 10,000. So many people have been dropping in on my porch and actually sending it to church via Target or Instacart. So there's so many ways you can do this without actually having to get there on Tuesday, whether you can't remember, you want to be safe, whatever the situation is, but let's be in mission. Let's go out and serve. We can't be in worship right now, so let's serve and let's do it really well to help the people at LifeWise most especially. And let's not lose sight of that we're also trying to raise that $15,000 for a week's worth of food. So if diapers aren't your thing, although they're very important, and three, four, five are the size diapers they need. But we do have the $15,000 goal, which again, between the two churches, not just our Green Trails Church. But it's so fun to see you in mission. It's so fun. We hope to see you soon in worship again. But we're so excited to, and keep looking for opportunities to meet Pastor Linda. She really wants to meet you. So keep looking at your e-news and other opportunities. And have a great, cool day, and welcome to worship.
Good morning, and welcome to worship at Green Trails Church. I'm Jeffrey Heil. I'm the director of music, and our team today is our pastor, Dr. Linda Settles, Bill Fenlon on guitar and vocals, and Emily Heil on vocals, and Amy Olson on vocals, Sam Heil on vocals, and playing the keyboard bass, our media team is Erica and Rocky. It is our joy to be here and to be in the house of the Lord together. Bill's going to read the beginning of Psalm 147 as our call to worship.
Good morning, everyone. This will be verses 1 through 11, Psalm 147. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise Him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our God and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music to our God on the harp. He covers the sky with clouds. He supplies the earth with rain and makes grass grow on the hills. He provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they call. His pleasure is not in the strength of the horse, nor his delight in the legs of the warrior. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. Thank you. And now we will have our first song. If you've got your hymnals at home, it's 103, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
Immortal, invisible, God only morning, and thank you to the music ministry for setting the atmosphere of praise on this beautiful Sabbath day. Would you join me in prayer? Eternal God, we thank you for the gift of another day, Lord. We thank you for waking us up this morning, and we thank you for bringing us into the worship experience. Lord, we know that you are mighty in all your ways, awesome, majestic, and glorious, and we came to worship you on this morning. And Father, we are ever mindful of those who don't know you. Help us to be the ones to engage with them. Help us to be the ones to go out and spread the gospel to them, Lord. Help us to do what it is you taught your disciples to do, to go, therefore, and make disciples. And now together, may we pray the prayer that the Lord taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we will be blessed by the children's moment from Rita Goddard.
Good morning, Green Trails Church. I'm Rita Goddard, Connectional Ministries Director, and I am so excited to bring you the children's moment today. When you have great news to share, how does that make you feel? I know I am like super excited that I just can't wait to share with my best friend. And sometimes my news is so great, I'll share it with a complete stranger. And there's many types of news that we like to share. For example, we could have made this great craft like we're doing in virtual VBS next week, and we think it's so neat that we can't wait to share it with mom and dad. It could be a mother that is so excited that their child finally slept through the night. No, it wasn't 8 hours, but I'm just happy with six. Or it could be this great big stuffed animal that you got. But even though this animal is big and fluffy, there's a real reason why that stuffed animal is so special. It's because my cousin gave it to me. And my cousin is super nice. She's always there for me. When I'm feeling sad, she tries to lift me up and make me happy. And if something comes up, she's willing just to drop everything and to be with me. And when I'm telling you how great my cousin is, you also can understand why she is such a great person. And that's kind of like our scripture today. It's about Paul, and Paul is so excited about some news that he just wants to share it with everybody. And do you know what his news is? That's right, he wants to share about Jesus. Paul is so excited about Jesus and Jesus' story that he shares it with complete strangers. And he shares that passion so much that these people become believers. Isn't that just amazing what Paul did, that he's so willing to share the story of Jesus with others? So like for me, sharing my story about how my cousin is so special to me, we also should find those opportunities to tell people how Jesus is so special to us. So let's end our children's moment here with a prayer. And we're going to ask God to give us guidance and strength that we can find ways, because I know it's really hard and it makes us uncomfortable, that we can share the story of Jesus with others. Dear God, we are so excited that we know Jesus. Give us strength to show others our excitement and share what Jesus means to us. Help us find ways to let others know about Jesus. In your name we pray, amen.
All I once held, this world reveres and wars to own, all I want. pounds thought gain I have counted loss, spent in worthless now compared to this. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is
Hallelujah, and thank the praise team for that beautiful selection. This morning, we are talking about being engaged, because remember, we're doing a sermon series for the month of July, and this is the second in that series, the I Lead, I Love, I Engage, I Accept, and I Disciple. So we have number two today. Amen. Would you pray with me?
If you abide in me, and my word abides in you, then you shall ask what you will, and it shall be given. If you abide in me, and my word abides in you, then you shall ask what you will, and it shall be given to you.
Heavenly Father, we come asking on this morning, asking to be closer to you through the word. Speak to our hearts on today, Lord, and give us open ears that we may clearly hear from you. And use me, Father, as an instrument of your will. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Our text for the morning is from Acts chapter 17, verses 16 through 34. It's a little bit long, but bear with me. I'm coming from the New International Version. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and Gentiles,
God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. A group asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know this new teaching that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Verse 22. Then Paul stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. He is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man, he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far away from any of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. Verse 32. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. So last week we talked about the God who loved us when we weren't so lovable and how we need to do the same for others. We need to love them to life. This week we're going to join the children in this text, in the story of Paul when he was in Athens, and see how we can help others to know Jesus, because knowing Jesus is everything. Amen. So I guess I would call this sermon Fully Engaged, because Paul was totally engaged in sharing the gospel message. And no doubt there have been moments in our lives when we've had moments of full awareness, that laser focus on what's happening right here and right now. It might have occurred when you were playing with your children or your grandchildren, and you were totally focused on them and their joy, and you got that goosebump moment, and you thought to yourself, can life get any better than this? Or maybe it's just me. Or maybe you traveled somewhere and you were keenly aware of the different sights and sounds and smells, memories that are etched on your heart because you were fully engaged in the moment. Or perhaps it's the excitement of a new love. You know, in the beginning, everything is new, amen, and inspiring. Oh, if we could only put that feeling in a bottle for when the hard times hit. It's okay, just say hallelujah, and nobody will know. See, when you're fully engaged in a thing, everything else is secondary. We don't hold back.
We feel alive, and many times the results are more than we could have imagined. And in our text, the Apostle Paul was fully engaged in sharing the gospel. Now, this time was a part of Paul's second missionary journey. And the way that he ended up in Athens was because he was preaching the gospel in Thessalonica, winning souls to Christ. But some of the Jews got jealous and formed a posse against him. So Paul and Silas were sent to Berea. But Paul kept on preaching. And then when the Thessalonians found out that he was in Berea, they came to stir things up there. But the believers took Paul to Athens. Now you would think after escaping an angry mob twice that Paul would be cool. But remember, he was fully engaged with the gospel. So Paul got busy. He couldn't help himself. When you've got a laser focus on the gospel, it opens your eyes to what's not right in the world. So the first thing Paul did, he engaged the community. As Paul walked around, he saw a need. The people were practicing idolatry in verse 16, and Paul was distressed. He was upset. He was righteously angry about it. So let me ask you, when you look at the world, what causes your heart to break? In his book, Walking with Nehemiah, Dr. Joe Daniels encourages churches to walk around their communities and see what it is that breaks your heart. That's your point of engagement. That's where you need to focus your energy. And church, I know that there are needs in our own backyard. We already do mission and service projects with neighborhood schools and organizations, and that is awesome. But what are you personally focused on? Whose needs are you praying about? And what about those needs that aren't so visible? What about teens who are in need of an encouraging word? What about the workaholic who finds it easier to engage with a computer than their own family? Or those who can't get through the day without a drink or a high? There are real unmet needs in our communities. But we've got to see them. We've got to love that person and be willing to engage them. So Paul engaged the community, but he also engaged the church. The first thing he would do when he arrived in a city is go to the synagogue. He reasoned with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks in Athens. And oh, if we could just reason together, church. Amen. If we could have healthy, crucial conversations. And even if we don't agree, we can at least agree to disagree while continuing to love. Wouldn't that be something? The reason we have so many denominations and offshoots of denominations today is because over the centuries, we have had disagreements. Women can't wear pants in church. Men's heads need to be covered. Women can't preach. Come on, somebody. We have found so many ways to divide and separate the church. But God is not separated. And God expects us to use the ministry of reconciliation that he gave us and engage one another in healthy ways. The United Methodist Church has been torn on the issue of sexual orientation and sexual identity, and the General Conference will meet again next fall because of COVID. And it's okay to have different views because we have varying theological perspectives, but it is not okay to vilify or crucify others because we don't agree. Can we just reason together and figure out how we can stay together? So Paul engaged the church, but he also engaged the world views of the time. There were a couple of groups that were there, the Epicureans. They were ones that were all about pleasure. They thought that there was no connection between people and the divine, and life was all about your contentment and satisfaction, and that's all there is. There's no resurrection. Satisfaction is king. And then the Stoics were there. And they placed thinking above feeling and tried to live in harmony with nature and reason. They suppressed their desire for pleasure, and they were very disciplined. They equated God with the universe and its physical matter, and natural laws were king for them. There's no incarnation and no resurrection. And then there were those who were just sitting around. Those looking for the latest ideas, you know, the foreigners and other Athenians, they would gather probably at the barbershop or the hairdresser, I don't know, and talk about the latest ideas, amen. They knew a lot of stuff, but they had no clue about the gospel. And we know some folks like that, amen. And the location here was at the Areopagus, the hill of Ares. And Ares was the god of war in Greek mythology. But the Areopagus was also the name of the council that met there. So whether Paul was on the hill itself or addressing the council, he came to do war against idolatry. And Paul noticed this strange inscription on an altar to an unknown god. Isn't that strange? To an unknown god. But it shows us that there was a disconnect somewhere. They were disengaged from the god that they worshiped. Or could there be a god that we really don't know about? So Paul minced no words in telling them in verse 23, "So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship." Now see, if I said that to somebody, y'all wouldn't like it. But this is Paul speaking, amen? And he told them boldly, "So you are ignorant of the very thing that you worship." Well, let me ask you a question. Would you marry somebody that you didn't know? Probably not. Now, I'm not talking about life after lockup or married at first sight. Okay, those are reality shows intended to make you real confused and throw you into Epicurean thought. I want it all and I want it now. It's all about me and what I want. You know, a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. My mama used to say, "You know just enough to be dangerous, girl." And church, unless you fully engage in the message of the gospel, your limited knowledge could get you in a world of trouble or bring you a world of hurt. And when we look at the state of the world today, we see that many have disengaged from the church. They've disengaged from prayer and even disengaged from the Bible. How many people do you see out there talking about the Lord? And generally, they fall into one of two camps. Either it doesn't feel good to me, Epicurean thought, or it doesn't make sense to me, a Stoic thought. Either way, something is missing in their lives. They're disengaged. But guess what? We can help others to know Jesus if we engage them in conversation. So Paul proceeds to break down the gospel to help them to know Jesus. And in verses 24 through 28, Paul makes some doctrinal statements that rocked their world. He told them that since God created the world and everything in it, he didn't need a house to live in. He transcends creation. God doesn't need people to wait on him or give him anything because guess what? He owns everything. This was a challenge to their earthly kings and their self-serving gods, little g, who kept the people giving to their own coffers. Paul told them that God inhabited the whole earth through one man, Adam, which challenged the Stoics because God isn't in creation, but distinct from it and humanity. In verse 27, Paul referenced Greek literature when he told them that we are to reach out for God. Now, in Greek literature, this gives the image of a blind person trying to reach out, walking in darkness. In other words, Paul was saying, if you're not seeking God, you're still walking in darkness. That's a word for us, amen. And remember, the Greeks were big on philosophy. They were great thinkers, but you can't rationalize the spirit. So Paul takes a masterful approach, and he quotes two philosophers in verse 28. Epimenides, he wrote, "For in him we live and move and have our being." And then Paul quotes the Stoic philosopher, Aratus, who wrote, "We are his offspring." And then Paul dares to weave the two statements together in reference to the God of Israel. I love the way Paul weaves theology into philosophy. And since all things were created by God, and all things come of thee, O Lord, even a philosophical thought can lead you to Jesus. We don't need to separate reason from the spirit. In fact, John Wesley's Quadrilateral encourages us to use our reason, our experience, our scripture, and our tradition in order to know God more fully. So we engage with reason as we come to know God more fully. Paul engaged their own philosophy to make his point, especially since their own philosophy had them confused, worshiping an unknown God. He found some common ground, and he expanded on it. So while they thought they were putting Paul on trial, Paul put their philosophy on trial and brought his point home in verse 29. Therefore, since we're God's offspring, God can't be made of gold or silver or stone, because guess what? They don't create anything. When was the last time a stone created another stone? They don't birth anything. But we're God's offspring, so God can't be made of gold or silver or stone. Remember, Paul was addressing their idolatry. Paul engaged them with the truth of the gospel right where they were. And he used familiar examples of idols and shrines, and he found common ground. He used their language, their culture, and their beliefs, and then he moved them toward a decision for Christ. And friends, we can follow the same formula. You don't need lofty words. You don't even need a Bible to tell somebody about Jesus. All you need to do is tell them what he's done for you. Tell them how you were hopeless, and then you realize your hope was built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Tell them you were once depressed, but the joy of the Lord became your strength and brought you back to light. Tell them you once chased after material things, but now you're chasing after Jesus, taking hold of that which took hold of you. Keep pressing forward, church, and taking the gospel out to your family and your friends and your job and even this world. Engage them where they are. Tell them about the love of Jesus that sets us free. Tell them if they seek Jesus first, he'll give them the desires of their heart. Tell them that they're chosen, a royal priesthood, God's child, precious and honored in his sight. Invite them to come to Jesus, to sing to Jesus, to fall on Jesus, to cry to Jesus, to dance for Jesus. And one day we will fly to Jesus. And remember, we started out saying when you fully engage in something, the results are sometimes more than you even imagined. Oh, Paul had some results. Sure, some of them sneered, but guess what? A member of the council believed, and a woman believed, and many others came to believe too. See, we must be willing to take the risk and engage people with the good news of Jesus Christ. God's word won't return to him void, but it will do what God intended for it to do, even if it's just one or two people. And it may not even happen in your lifetime. You see, that member of the council needed Jesus in order to make good decisions, because there's more to life than Rome. That woman needed Jesus because she realized that there's more to her life, that Jesus loved her too. She wasn't a second-class citizen. And you too can help others to know Jesus. Then they'll know that there's more to their lives than what they're experiencing. For God so loved the world that he fully engaged. He gave his only begotten son so that whoever chooses to fully engage, whoever believes in him, man, woman, boy, or girl, shall not perish, but shall fully engage in everlasting life. Oh, we've got to love them to life, church. And then we've got to fully engage them in the gospel. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus. And live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away. and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. And go at peace and laugh at glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live.
Thank you, Sam, for that beautiful response to the sermon. Isn't it awesome that we get to invite others to come to Jesus? We get to engage them with the gospel message. And we just want to take time out now and thank you for the ways that you continue to give to the church here at Green Trails. The music ministry has given through their gifts on today, and many of you came to the porch drop. I met a lot of folks on Tuesday, and you give through your mission efforts. And also we give through our tithes and offerings. So we encourage you to either mail it in or drop it by the church office, or you can also text to give. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you for everything that you are doing through this church. We thank you for the many ways that we serve this community and we are a blessing to so many people. And Father, we are ever mindful of the need. So we just ask that you would continue to bless the giving. Let it continue to flow, that there may continue to be ministries that will bear fruit throughout this land. In the name of Jesus Christ, the one you have given to us, we pray. Amen. And now our final selection is hymn number 702, Sing with All the Saints in Glory. The words will be on the screen, so please sing along with us.
Sing the resurrection song.
Amen. Well, we want to remind you that on Tuesday we will have our porch drop. All month long we're doing diapers and donations, so come on by, and I will be here again this Tuesday, so I'd love to meet you. We pray that you have been blessed in worship today through song and the word, and receive this final benediction. God of grace and God of glory, we thank you, Lord, for reminding us that there's nothing like knowing Jesus. Help us to realize that we need to fully engage with those all around us, those we know and those we don't even know, so that they too may come to know the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they too shall be saved. Now may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.